Well, hello, Young America's Foundation. Welcome to our nation's capital. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. Governor Scott Walker is my friend. He is one of the premier conservative leaders in America. But he knows me well enough to know the introduction I prefer is a little bit shorter. I'm a Christian, a conservative, and a Republican in that order, and it's my honor to be at the 44th Annual National Conservative Student Conference for YAF. Thank you all. You know, for nearly 50 years, YAF has been the premier organization, inspiring freedom-loving young people across this country, and I'm just honored to be with you. And it's a particular joy, as Governor Walker just mentioned, to be here with a Marine Corps mom, my wife of 37 years, a Christian school teacher, and the best second lady the United States of America has ever had. Would you join me in thanking my wife, Karen Pence, one more time? You know, speaking of home, our lives have changed a lot since the last time we were together. We moved back to Indiana. We bought 5 acres in a pond. I got a riding mower, John Deere, zero turn radius, 54-inch deck, 25 horsepower. You know, the good part about no longer being vice president is you get to drive your own car. Bad part is you get to pay for your own gas. And Karen and I can confirm now, with personal experience, the governor, you can actually be a congressman from your home state for 12 years. You can be the governor of your home state for 4. You can even be vice president of the United States of America. But you're still going to wait 25 minutes for a table at Olive Garden on Saturday night at 7 o'clock. My daughter writes for the Daily Wire. When I texted her and told her we'd waited 25 minutes, she said, "That's America, Dad." And you know what? She's right. Only in America, everybody. This is about we the people. But it's good to be with you all. And I came today with the intention of speaking to you about a broad range of topics. But the weather had different plans for me yesterday, so today I'm going to take the opportunity to speak about an agenda for the future. It's all about freedom. You know, the uniquely American idea that all men are created equal and are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights of life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness is the essence of American freedom. And that idea of American freedom has created the most prosperous nation in the history of the world. We have astounded the world now for centuries with our innovation, our creativity, and our generosity. And it's all been driven, as people here at YAFCON know, by our commitment to freedom. But sadly, as we gather here today, American freedom is under attack. Big tech, big media, big government, even big business have locked arms to advance a pernicious woke agenda designed to control the American people and destroy the American dream. The ruling elites here in Washington and all across this country have never been more out of touch with the values of everyday Americans, but never more intent on imposing their agenda on each and every one of us. I hardly need to tell those of you that have been standing up as conservatives on campus about the cancel culture in which we live today and what I like to call the intolerance of tolerance in 2022. Over many decades, liberal policies created one disaster after another. As we gather today, our borders are under siege. Our currency has been devalued. Our energy independence has been squandered. And our great and booming economy is being brought to a screeching halt by big government socialism. Make no mistake about it, Yaffers. There is a cure for what ails America, and that is leadership committed to American freedom. Now more than ever, we need to lead America with a freedom agenda focused on the future. And as I said, I had planned to unveil this agenda at the Heritage Foundation last night, but my plane was diverted against that terrible storm you all witnessed. And I just figured, with Karen at my side, that God must have had different plans for today. In fact, he must have decided that a talk about the future, a talk about an agenda for the future, should be given to the rising generation. A talk about the freedom agenda should be given to the freedom generation. And I'm honored to be here. You know, the conservative movement has always been built on the notion that ideas have consequences. Conservatism is bigger than any one moment, any one election, or any one person. It's always been about ideas. And YAF has been there every step of the way for half a century, inspiring Americans who cherish those ideals of freedom. And I know you'll continue to do just that. And I'm proud to say, under the Trump-Pence administration, it was those ideas that drove our policies every single day. Advancing American freedom, we achieved the lowest unemployment, the highest household income, the most energy production, the most pro-trade American deals, the most secure border, and the most powerful military the history has ever known. We did it all. Now, all those accomplishments were possible because of your support and the support of conservatives of every age and every background in this country. But as I said, I came today not to look backwards, but to look forward. The truth of the matter is, now more than ever, conservatives need to be focused on the challenges Americans are facing today and offer a bold and positive agenda of solutions for the future. The Bible tells us, where there is no vision, the people perish. And as the American people witness the consequences of the American left abandoning our most cherished ideals and values every day, those words ring more true. With the worst border crisis in history, inflation at a 40-year high, gasoline prices through the roof, and our foreign adversaries like Russia and China emboldened by American weakness, with future generations being saddled with trillions of dollars in debt. Now more than ever, we need leadership and vision. But in 2022, the good news is we have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to save America from decline and decay brought on by those progressive policies and to build a governing majority that will last for generations. But in order to win, conservatives need to do more than criticize and complain. We must unite our movement behind a bold, optimistic agenda that offers a clear and compelling choice to the American people. And that's exactly what the organization I founded, called Advancing American Freedom, set out to do. With the help of more than 50 of the brightest stars of the conservative movement, including Scott Walker and Newt Gingrich and Rick Santorum and Betsy DeVos, who you'll hear from a little bit later today, I posed the question to that team. Describe for us the ideas that have animated the movement, the conservative movement all across this country from Reagan to Trump, and put them all in one place. That was how our freedom agenda was born. There are solutions there that are designed to be implemented at all levels of government. But you know, Congress can't solve every problem facing our country, and it shouldn't try. You know, a careful study of Congress shows that throughout our history, Congress has done two things well: nothing and overreact. And so our freedom agenda is about equipping Americans just like you to be able to make the case for freedom, with your neighbors and friends and families and coworkers. You can follow along with the Freedom Agenda if you want to go to advancingamericanfreedom.com, but let me describe it for you briefly. We begin our Freedom Agenda with a focus on American culture. Now, why is that? Well, the late Andrew Breitbart often said, politics is downstream from culture. If we allow the radical left to continue dumping toxic waste into the headwaters of our culture, our politics will get more poisonous than ever. You know, the American people are proud of our culture. They believe it's worth protecting for future generations. As Americans, we believe in those timeless ideals of life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness. So where we begin with the Freedom Agenda is a very simple commitment to secure the sanctity of life at the center of American law once again. I stand before you today with a grateful heart that after nearly 50 years of lives of incalculable value lost to our nation, 50 years of heartbreak, 50 years of praying and fasting and working and volunteering and caring. Last month, at long last, with the support of three Supreme Court justices appointed during the Trump-Pence administration, we sent Roe versus Wade to the ash heap of history where it belongs. But in a very real sense, we've only come to the end of the beginning. As my fellow conservatives, now it falls to this generation to take the case for life to every state and every state house in America. Our Freedom Agenda calls for advancing pro-life protections in every state in the union, every single one. We call for expanding support for women in crisis pregnancies to support the unborn and to support the newborn with equal American generosity. We call for reforming adoption laws so more forever families can be formed, because you can't be pro-life if you're not pro-adoption. And finally, we call for ending all taxpayer funding of abortion and defunding Planned Parenthood once and for all. Let me say from my heart to each and every one of you in this rising generation, I believe the destiny of our nation is inextricably linked to restoring the unalienable right to life for every American, born and unborn. So we must not rest. We must not relent. We must not tire until we've restored the sanctity of life to the center of American law in every state in the nation. We save the babies, we'll save America. So our culture agenda begins with the sanctity of life, but it also involves securing liberty. That means defending religious liberty and freedom of speech from the censorship coercion of cancel culture. It means securing our border, supporting law enforcement. It means finishing the wall and giving the men and women of law enforcement the support they deserve every single day. Now, critical race theory is nothing more than state-sanctioned racism, and it should be rejected in every community, in every school in the nation. We need to purge our schools of critical race theory and restore patriotic education in every classroom in America. And the time has come to allow every family to choose where their children go to school, regardless of their income or area code. School choice, this time has come. And with President Joe Biden, in his State of the Union address, pledging to protect the God-given right of men to compete in women's sports, we need to end the assault on women's sports by the radical gender left and defend the opportunities for women athletics for generations. And lastly, on culture, we need to defend the right of every law-abiding citizen to keep and bear arms under the Second Amendment of the United States. That includes our proposal to enact right-to-carry laws and constitution carry, just like we did in the state of Indiana this summer. There was a lot of debate about that constitutional carry bill when we were moving it in Indiana, but things got a little bit quiet about a week ago when a young man took his girlfriend to the Greenwood Park Mall, had a sidearm with him, which he was able to carry because of that constitutional carry provision. And then a murderous gunman showed up with enough firepower to claim hundreds of lives. July 19th, they're in the food court at the Greenwood Park Mall, not far from where we raised our kids. A young man named Alicia Dickens, from just south of where I grew up, drew his firearm, told people to take cover, and fired an approach and took that gunman down in minutes. Firearms in the hands of law-abiding citizens makes our communities more safe, not less safe. We need to stand for the Second Amendment. Next on our freedom agenda is American opportunity. It's restoring the vitality of our economy through free market principles. You know, the American free enterprise system is the most powerful economic engine in the history of mankind. No other system has created more wealth, lifted more people out of poverty, or improved the quality of life for more people to a greater degree. So to restore American freedom and greatness, the free market must be unleashed from the shackle of high taxes, overregulation, and big government socialism. But I need to tell all of you, with inflation raging all across the country, and the Treasury Secretary saying this past weekend that we may well be headed into recession in this economy, now more than ever, we need to go back to what we know works. Freedom works. You know, under the Trump-Pence administration, we knew how to fix the economy. Under the 8 years that preceded us, we'd seen the slowest economic recovery since the Great Depression. With the policies that we implemented, we gained more than 7 million good-paying jobs. Unemployment plummeted to the lowest rate in 50 years. And the unemployment rate for African Americans and Hispanic Americans reached the lowest level ever recorded. Household income soared. More than 10 million people were lifted off of welfare. And under our freedom agenda, we call for the same policies again. We call on our leaders in Washington in renewed majorities on Capitol Hill and renewed leadership to do essentially what we did in our successful playbook. Number one, we need to permanently extend the Trump-Pence tax cuts for the American people. We need to eliminate special interest tax breaks and lower tax rates for working Americans and businesses. We need to support reciprocal trade deals that put American jobs and American workers first. And with gasoline prices soaring, I filled up my son-in-law's truck just 2 days ago in California. $6.50 a gallon. Cost $102. He's worth it. Men and women of YAF, we need to unleash American energy and lower the cost of gasoline at the pump with freedom. We need to roll back the regulatory state. You know, we reduced more federal red tape in our administration than any administration in American history. We need to expand health savings accounts, offer free market solutions in health care. And finally, as I stand before this rising generation, we need to renew our commitment to fiscal discipline and demand a balanced federal budget in the next 5 years. And finally, while we begin with culture and economic opportunity, lastly now, we turn to American leadership, restoring American strength by supporting a strong national defense. To provide for the common defense is the first obligation in the preamble of the Constitution. And the truth is, American freedom means peace at home and stability abroad. President John Quincy Adams said it well when he said that America must never, quote, go abroad in search of monsters to destroy, but we must promote freedom through the power of our example and stand faithfully with our allies in defense of our common values and interests. Only a strong America can lead. That's why, after years of reckless budget cuts, our administration rebuilt our military. We saw the largest increase in our national defense since the days of Ronald Reagan, $3 trillion in investments. And just as importantly, we got our NATO allies to contribute $400 billion more to our common defense. We not only invested in our military, we modernized our military and created the first new branch of our armed forces in 75 years, the United States Space Force. America is the leader of the free world, but today American leadership is hampered by this administration's flagging commitment to our national defense, flatlining investments in our national defense, and the disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan. President Biden's withdrawal from Afghanistan was a disgrace, and it dishonored the service and sacrifice of every American who served in that nation to defend our country over the past 20 years. But let me say, to all those who served and to the families of our fallen, nothing of that disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan will ever diminish the gratitude of the American people for your service in that nation defending our freedom. But the truth is, weakness arouses evil. The Trump-Pence administration was the only administration in the 21st century where Russia did not seek to redraw international lines by force. And there was a reason. The truth is, President Biden has squandered much of the deterrence that we had set in place in our administration. Not only the disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan, but capitulating on Nord Stream 2 before war broke out in Eastern Europe, and re-entering the intermediate range nuclear treaty that we had withdrawn from because of Russia's actions. Let me say this: as Russia continues its unconscionable war of aggression in Ukraine, conservatives must make it clear that Putin must stop, or Putin will pay. Our freedom agenda calls for continually marshaling support for freedom fighters in Ukraine. We need to continue to put economic pressure, and we need to continue to isolate Russia until peace is restored for the good people of Ukraine. You know, I've stood toe-to-toe with Vladimir Putin. I've looked him in the eye and told him things he didn't want to hear. And I can tell you this much. Putin only understands strength. And we must meet his grandiose ambitions with American strength for the sake of our allies and the free world. So too must we meet Communist China's ambitions in the Asia Pacific. You know, I'm proud to say the Trump-Pence administration changed the national consensus on China. The American people are more awake today to the trade abuses, the human rights abuses, to all of the actions that China has been perpetrating across the Asia Pacific with military aggression over the last 10 years. But under the Biden administration, China has grown more aggressive, trampling human rights, committing even more trade abuses, repressing religious liberty, subjugating Hong Kong, and menacing Taiwan. You know, appeasement has never worked any time in history, and it won't work now. Peace and economic progress proceed from American strength. So under our freedom agenda, we must see China as the greatest threat to our economy and our liberty in the 21st century. We must continue to bring economic pressure on China. We must hold China accountable for trade abuses, speak out on human rights. And America must be prepared for the great power competition with the Chinese Communist Party and a resurgent Russia, with a military fit for the task. This means funding our military and making sure our servicemen and women have the resources and support they need to accomplish their mission and come home safe. Our goal must be nothing short of ensuring American dominance on land and sea and air and space. And let me say, we should treat our soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and Guardians like they were our own family. Because they are. You know, I'm proud to say I'm the father of a captain in the United States Marine Corps and the father-in-law of a lieutenant in the United States Navy. And our all-volunteer military are the best of us because they come from the rest of us. And so we need to give the American military service men and women our best, America. That means passing robust defense budgets focused on the threats of today and tomorrow. It means building a 350-ship Navy. It means expanding the Space Force and Space Command. And under our freedom agenda, it also means ending the social experiments that began during Obama and are continuing during President Biden. We have to end the woke culture in the military of the United States of America. And with that renewed American strength, we should stand with our allies and stand up to our enemies as never before. Our freedom agenda calls for countering Iranian aggression with further isolation and pressure. We need to put a stake in the heart of the Iran nuclear deal once and for all. We need to fortify alliances in our Western Hemisphere. We need to make it clear that in the Western Hemisphere, libertad is the order of the day, and let us stand with freedom-loving people in Venezuela, in Nicaragua, and que viva Cuba Libre. And finally, if the world knows nothing else, let the world know this. America stands with Israel. We need to renew our commitment to our most cherished ally and build on the progress of the Abraham Accords. So there you have it, my fellow young Americans. A freedom agenda built on renewing our culture, renewing opportunity for every American, renewing American strength and leadership. I commend it to your attention. I believe this freedom agenda provides a clear roadmap for conservative leaders like all of you to connect deeply with the American people on their top priorities. It's built on the belief that Americans want to create more economic opportunity. We want American leadership in the world, and that we cherish our culture. On these ideas, I believe we can unite this conservative movement, which has maybe been more important than ever before. You know, the need has never been greater for a unified conservative action. When you see the aggressive liberalism of this administration and their allies in the Congress. Frankly, 2022 may be the best chance we will ever have to build a lasting majority, to invigorate the conservative movement, to fulfill conservatism's purpose, and to save our nation from the left-wing tyranny, socialism, and decline. Now, some people may choose to focus on the past, but elections are about the future. And I believe conservatives must focus on the future to win back America. We can't afford to take our eyes off the road in front of us, because what's at stake is the very survival of our way of life. In 2022, the American people will decide whether their children and grandchildren will stand tall as citizens of the freest nation on earth, or whether they'll be forced to live in the economic, moral, and spiritual decline of socialism. When conservatives focus on winning the future, we won't just win the next election. We will change the course of American history for generations. So I thank you for your attention. I look forward to your questions, but let me say this. You know, we've all been through a lot over the last few years. A global pandemic, civil unrest, a divisive election, a tragic day in our nation's capital, and a Democrat administration seemingly intent on weakening America at home and abroad. But I want to assure all of you, I remain incredibly optimistic, because I know the future belongs to freedom. And I know the character of the American people. Traveling all across this country as your vice president, 20 years in public office, active in the conservative movement, I can attest firsthand. The American people always rise to the challenge. We always right the ship when our leaders veer off course. And my hope and my prayer is that this freedom agenda will be a beacon to help Americans navigate through these rough waters to a boundless American future, a future of freedom. So let's keep fighting the good fight. Let's finish the race. And most of all, let's keep the faith. Let's keep faith with our heritage of freedom, enshrined in that Declaration of Independence and Constitution. Let's keep faith with millions of Americans who know in their heart of hearts that the sun has not set on the land of the free. And most of all, let's never forget that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. And if we will but renew our faith in Him, I know the best days for the greatest nation on earth are yet to come. So thank you, yeah. God bless you, and God bless America.
Thank you, Vice President Mike Pence. We have some time for questions. Please state your name, your school, and a brief question.
Great.
Hi, Mr. Vice President. First of all, thank you so much for being here.
Hi, what's your name?
And my name's Andrew Burchard. I go to Gettysburg College.
Hi, Andrew.
And my question is, President Trump and yourself are both speaking this week in D.C., and there seems to be a divide between the two of you on your outlook on what the future of the conservative movement might be. So do you think that this divide extends to the rest of the conservative movement, like the general public, and what do you think we can do to alleviate it?
Well, I will tell you that I couldn't be more proud of the record of the Trump-Pence administration. I mean, for 4 years, we advanced the policies that I just described without apology, to promote a growing economy, to secure our border. We appointed more than 300 conservatives to our federal courts at every level, including 3 Supreme Court justices. We rebuilt our military, all of what I described. And I'll always be grateful for the opportunity to serve as vice president. So I don't know that our movement is that divided. I don't know that the president and I differ on issues. But we may differ on focus. I truly do believe that elections are about the future. And that it's absolutely essential at a time when so many Americans are hurting, so many families are struggling, that we don't give way to the temptation to look back. But I think the time has come for us to offer a bold, positive agenda to bring America back. And I'll continue to carry that message all across this nation. Thanks, Edward.
All right, we've got time for one more question.
Good morning, Mr. Vice President.
Good morning. What's your name?
I am Wyatt Phillips, and I'm from the University of Iowa. You once visited our school and said that we were a small but mighty chapter, and I believe that many of us in this room feel the same way about the will of the people in Taiwan. So my question for you would be, what is an effective way, or at least the first few steps, that we can secure their freedom?
Well, first and foremost, thank you. Thanks for the warm welcome when I visited the University of Iowa. You know, if you look at our freedom agenda, you'll see we speak very plainly about China. I mean, I'm proud of the fact the Trump-Pence administration changed the national consensus on China. For more than 20 years, there was the hope that if we increased economic exchange and trade with China, that we would strengthen private property rights and ultimately individual freedom. But the truth is, what we realize is that the opposite has happened. The more the economy of China has grown, the more their trade abuses have increased. The more the economy has grown, the more they've invested in a military that demonstrates aggression in the South China Sea and in the Taiwan Straits. And the more their military has grown, most grievously, religious persecution against Christians and Muslim Uyghurs has increased in human rights abuses. You know, Jimmy Lai is a business leader in Hong Kong who languishes in jail right now, a man of profound Christian faith. His only offense is that he believed in freedom for the people of Hong Kong. So I think there's no shortcut to what we need to do to continue to defend the interest of freedom in the Asia Pacific, and that is we need to invest in the strongest military in the history of the world and make it stronger still. We need to redouble our commitment to defend our treaty allies all across the Asia Pacific. And in that sense, I think that we answer that moment with China. Continuing tariffs that we've placed on China to hold them accountable for their trade abuses, that we call them out on the espionage and intellectual property theft in which they've engaged in extraordinary numbers in recent years. But more than anything else, the way we can look after our friends and allies in Taiwan, the way we can look after all the freedom-loving nations of the Asia Pacific, is renew our commitment to have the strongest military in the world and to preserve a free and open Indo-Pacific with American strength. Well, you all have a great day ahead of you, Betsy DeVos, Ben Carson, but let me just say thank you again on behalf of my wife and all of us in this movement. Thanks for stepping forward to lead. I know that I am looking at a generation that will lead this country, a generation that will turn this country around. Just do everything in your part, in your heart of hearts, to be the freedom generation, YAF, because the best is yet to come. Thank you very much. God bless you.